Yeah. We are reading from Psalm 18, verses 1 through 6. Working on applying it myself. It's really great to be with you guys this morning. As you know, I missed a bunch of Sundays. traveling up to New Hampshire and stuff there and all that. And so it's great to be back with you. Psalm 18, verses 1 through 6. One more thing. We're going to be teaching this Sunday about the glory of God and through Jesus. Am I correct in that? As you read along with me, be thinking about that. What is this telling me about Jesus and how glorious he is? I love you, O Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer. My God, my rock in whom I take refuge. My shield, and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. I call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised, and I am saved from my enemies. The cords of death encompassed me. The torrents of destruction assailed me. The cords of Sheol entangled me. The snares of death confronted me. In my distress, I called upon the Lord. To my God, I cried for help. From his temple, he heard my voice, and my cry to him reached his ears. Let's pray. Father, we praise you that right now, we ask you for little things like the Sunday service, and that we would not just be sitting here hearing some earthly wisdom and some good ideas, but we'd be hearing you. That we know that you hear that plea and desire to grant that, and you desire to make yourself known. So that is what we ask, that you hear our plea and you make yourself known to us, reveal the glory of Jesus, show us you, and may we worship you this morning and praise you and thank you for all your gifts. In your name, amen.
Wanted to remind you guys one more time about these counseling mini books that are in the lobby out there. They're the kind of things that are designed to be read in 30 to 40 minutes. All kinds of topics, renewing marital intimacy, controlling anger, who should I date? So they've been out there for 2 or 3 weeks now. You're welcome to them. I'm doing some counting this morning, and from what I can tell, none of you are sinners because none of them are gone. But I have interacted with some of you, so I know you are sinners. So if you take one, we will not be flabbergasted if you're a sinner. So help yourself, and if you have friends that would benefit from one of these, feel free to take them one as well. All right, let's stand, and we will sing Jesus Paid It All.
Jesus, make it all.
a little context for the sermon this morning by dropping back into the passage that we preached on 4 weeks ago and read the final few verses of that passage. Read with me, please, at John 11, verses 38 through 44. This is about the resurrection of Lazarus, if you recollect. Then Jesus, deeply moved again, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone lay against it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, by this time there will be an odor, for he has been dead 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. And Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me. But I said this on account of the people standing around, that they may believe that you sent me." When he had said these things, he cried out with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" The man who had died came out, his hands and feet bound with linen strips, and his face wrapped with a cloth. Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." Let's pray. Our Father, we thank you for the Lord Jesus, who we saw 4 weeks ago and see again this morning, is the resurrection and the life. No man comes to the Father but by him. We praise you for the glory and the power and the majesty and the surpassing worth of Jesus. We pray, Father, that as we continue to sing, that your heart will be pleased by what you see taking place in our hearts and in our minds. We ask that you would be honored in our worship service today, Lord. We want to know you. We want to be found in you. We want to draw closer to you. And so we ask that you would enable all these things to happen as we sing and as we preach and as we hear the word and as we pray and as we take communion. Please draw near to us. Jesus, you are our life. Apart from you, we will die, both physically and spiritually. So come, Holy Spirit, and manifest Christ to our hearts and give us life through Jesus. We ask it in his name. Amen. Stand again, please.
Oh,
crucified many of the Jews, therefore, who had come with Mary, and had seen what he did, believed in him. But some of them went to the Pharisees and told them what Jesus had done. So the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered the council and said, "What are we to do? For this man performs many signs. If we let him go on like this, everyone will believe in him, and the Romans will come and take away both our place and our nation." But one of them, Caiaphas, who was high priest that year, said to them, "You know nothing at all, nor do you understand that it is better for you that one man should die for the people, not that the whole nation should perish." He did not say this of his own accord, but being high priest that year, he prophesied that Jesus would die for the nation. And not for the nation only, but also to gather into one the children of God who are scattered abroad. So from that day on, they made plans to put him to death. Jesus, therefore, no longer walked openly among the Jews, but went from there to the region near the wilderness to a town called Ephraim, and there he stayed with his disciples. Now the Passover of the Jews was at hand, and many went up from the country to Jerusalem before the Passover to purify themselves. They were looking for Jesus and saying to one another as they stood in the temple, "What do you think? That he will not come to the feast at all?" Now the chief priests and the Pharisees had given orders that if anyone knew where he was, he should let him know so that they might arrest him. Chapter 12. 6 days before the Passover, Jesus therefore came to Bethany, where Lazarus was, whom Jesus had raised from the dead. So they gave a dinner for him there. Martha served, and Lazarus was one of those reclining with him at table. Mary therefore took a pound of expensive ointment made from pure nard, and anointed the feet of Jesus, and wiped his feet with her hair. The house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. But Judas Iscariot, one of his disciples, he who was about to betray him, said, "Why was this ointment not sold for 300 denarii and given to the poor?" He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. And having charge of the money bag, he used to help himself to what was put into it. Jesus said, "Leave her alone, so that she may keep it for the day of my burial. For the poor you always have with you, but you do not always have money." When the large crowd of the Jews learned that Jesus was there, they came, not only on account of him, but also to see Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. So the chief priests made plans to put Lazarus to death as well, because on account of him, many of the Jews were going away and believing in Jesus. Let's pray again. Now, Father, we thank you for your word. Your word is true. We want to know the truth, because to know the truth is to know Christ. And so we pray that you would enable us to know Christ through this passage of Scripture today. Help us to see, Lord, as we look at these verses, where our thinking has been an error, where our measures of success and what is good and right have been skewed by the culture that we live in. And help us to think your thoughts after you. Father, we confess that we are so weak and so needy and so helpless apart from your grace, that unless you come and minister to each of our hearts, unless you come and help me to preach, nothing of any spiritual significance or import will be accomplished today. And so we just plead with you that you would have mercy on us, and that the Holy Spirit would fellowship with us. I pray for these dear people that you brought, both in person and online, that you would enable each one of them to hear the word of God and be changed. Help me, Lord, to hear the word of God and to be changed. Thank you for that wonderful promise that your word accomplishes the purpose that you send it out for. May that be the case today. I pray that you would grant me the power to preach, Lord. As I seek to preach, help me to think clearly, to speak clearly, to not fear man, to know you in the act of preaching, and Father, to preach that you might be pleased with me, and not to care one iota what anybody in this world thinks about it. Help me to want to please you above all things, Lord Jesus. We pray that you would continue to grow this church. We pray, Lord, that you would help us in the year ahead to know Jesus better than we ever have. We pray that you'd use this message today to that end. We
said, we left off 1 month ago with the resurrection of Lazarus from the dead. And if you remember, Lazarus died. His sister sent for Jesus. Jesus tarried. By the time Jesus got to Bethany, Lazarus had been dead for 4 days. Jesus came to the tomb and said, roll away the stone. They said, oh, don't do that. By this time, he's starting to rot. There's an odor. Jesus says, Lazarus, come out. And here comes the mummy. The mummy man, Lazarus, in front of hundreds of witnesses. You look at verse 44. It says, the man who had died came out, his hands and feet bound with linen strips, and his face wrapped with a cloth. Jesus said to them, unbind him and let him go. So the resurrection of Lazarus was an undeniable public miracle, an act of power, right there in front of God and everybody. And the thing that further made it so undeniable is the fact that the evidence for it was Lazarus himself. He was alive. You could go over and shake his hand and talk to him and say, hey man, what's it like to be dead? And so there was no refuting what Christ had done. And different people reacted to this miracle in different ways. The religious leaders reacted in one way. And Judas reacted in one way. And then Mary of Bethany reacted in an opposite way. And the contrast between these different reactions sheds light on how God evaluates human actions. You know, in different spheres of life, we use different metrics to measure success. So if you're in the army, you've done good if you obey your commanding officer. If you obey the army, you've done well. If you're in the business world and you turn a big profit, then you've done well. You've been successful. In the world of sports, if you're victorious and you win pennants and championships and such, then that is the measure of success. But how does God evaluate our actions? In this text, we see that God evaluates the motive behind our actions. What we do is important, but why we do it is even more important to God. So the question we're going to address is very simple. How does God evaluate our actions? And the first thing we see in this text is that God hates actions that are motivated by expediency, pragmatism, convenience, the desire to achieve some kind of intended effect or result. Jesus has raised Lazarus from the dead at Bethany. Now, Bethany was only 2 miles from Jerusalem. And so he performed this miracle basically on in the backyard of Israel's religious power brokers. He had come onto their turf, and he had flexed his muscles. Had raised Lazarus from the dead in their backyard. And so they have to respond. Look at verse 47 through 48 again, please. So the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered the council and said, what are we to do? For this man performs many signs. If we let him go on like this, everyone will believe in him. They said, we've got to do something, or everybody's going to believe in Jesus. What can we do? Now, this is an amazing response. It's amazing because it reveals the astonishing hardness of the human heart. These Jewish authorities cannot deny the fact that Lazarus was raised from the dead. And this miracle proves he's God Almighty. He's the promised Messiah. He's the Son of God. Yet, believing in Jesus is not even an option that has crossed their minds. It's as though the possibility of trusting in Christ and receiving him as their Messiah and as their King has never even occurred to them. This demonstrates a great truth. Faith is not fundamentally a matter of the head. It is a matter of the heart. Verse 48 again. If we let it go on like this, the council said, everyone will believe in him. It did not matter what other people did. The Sanhedrin, the Jewish authorities, they were determined. Jesus, I don't care what you do, I will not believe in you. Oh, how the proud human heart despises the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, many atheists will say, and perhaps you have some atheists in your circles of life,
convention, like they have one every year, at the National AIDS Convention, they actually have a time where they invite God to come and show up so that they can believe in Him. And so they'll have, you know, a 5 to 10 minute period of silence at the National AIDS Convention where they say, okay, God, if you exist, we're going to be quiet for 10 minutes. If you'll show up, we will believe in you. Well, the same Peter proves that faith is not a matter of the head alone. It is primarily a matter of the heart. Lazarus was there to see, to touch, to talk to, as undeniable proof that Jesus is the Messiah. Yet the Sanhedrin refused to believe in Jesus. So no amount of evidence, no amount of facts, no amount of data, no amount of proof can turn a heart of stone into a heart of flesh. A.W. Pink says this, quote, man's unbelief is a far more deeply seated disease than most people think. If we ourselves believe, we can never be too thankful. If you believe in Jesus today, you should be profoundly, deeply, eternally grateful that you believe, because it is a miracle that you trust in and value and love Jesus Christ. Look at verse 48 one more time, please. Council says if we let him go on like this, everyone will believe in him, and the Romans will come and take away both our place and our nation. Well, now we see the motivating force behind what the council, the Sanhedrin, is doing. They don't want their place and their nation taken away, so their place is the temple. We don't want our place taken away. And we don't want our nation taken away because we're Jews. And Rome gives us special privileges that they don't give other nations that they conquer. So they gave the Jewish people a certain measure of autonomy that they did not give to other nations. And they were able to practice the Jewish faith and settle some of their matters internally. And the council said, we don't want to lose this. We don't want to lose our place. We don't want to lose our nation. You see, the resurrection of Lazarus had caused a wave of excitement among the people. This guy must be the Messiah. And so Passover is very near. And what happens at Passover is the Jews from all over the Mediterranean world are coming back to Jerusalem. Tens of thousands of Jews. And what if all these Jews come back and there's like 250,000 Jews celebrating Passover and they all get wind that Jesus has done this and they think, we're going to put Jesus on our shoulders. We're going to make him king. And then the Romans would have to come in and squash the rebellion. And the Jews would lose their temple and their nation. That's what the council feared. So the driving force behind their decision to kill Jesus is this. We have to do something practical here. We have to kill Jesus. That's the only common sense practical thing to do to get the result to preserve our place and our nation. Now, this seems on its face like a noble concern. But what the Sanhedrin is really concerned with is preserving their own power and their own influence. See this at the end of verse 48. The Romans will come in and take away our place and our nation. Look at verse 49. But one of them, Caiaphas, who was high priest that year, said to them, you know nothing at all, nor do you understand it's better for you. It's better for you that one man should die for the people, not that the whole nation should perish. So really, they weren't concerned about the common folk. They weren't concerned about the nation. They were concerned about our place and our nation. Caiaphas said, listen, I'm going to tell you what's better for you. Caiaphas took control of the situation. And he said, guys, we got to keep our eyes fixed on the most important thing, which is this, our own interests. That has to be paramount. Forget truth. Forget justice. Forget righteousness. Forget the glory of God. Caiaphas says, what will preserve the status quo? What can we do to be practical? And therefore, Jesus must die. In fact, Lazarus must die too. Look at chapter 12, verses 9 through 11. Chapter 12, verses 9 through 11. When the large crowd of the Jews learned that Jesus was there, they came not only on account of him, but also to see Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. So the chief priests made plans to put Lazarus to death as well, because on account of him, many of the Jews were going away and believing in Jesus.
So it will not do to simply kill Jesus, because the evidence of his power is still there. We've got to kill Lazarus too. This is the only practical thing that we can do to save our position, to save our power, to save our wealth and our influence in this society. We have to act in a pragmatic way. You see, Caiaphas was interested in what works, instead of what honors God. Now, how many religious leaders do we have today in the United States of America who are motivated by what works instead of what is good and what is right and what is true? Ever since the Second Great Awakening and the days of Charles Finney, American evangelicalism has been increasingly dominated and influenced by pragmatism. Pragmatism just means, what can we do that'll get a result? Right? I have sat around a table with elders at a large church with hundreds of people going, and I said, guys, why do we have an addiction recovery ministry here that's founded on the principles of AA? Because AA was thought up by somebody who's not a Christian, and I realized that you took some Bible verses and kind of cut and pasted them to the AA model, half of them are out of context, but the problem is that this whole system was devised by an unbeliever. Why are we doing this? And the answer verbatim that I give is this: it works. It works. In other words, it's well-attended, people like it, and some people stop their bad habits. No consideration of whether this program is built on the gospel. No consideration of whether the participants are being pointed toward the Christ of the Bible. No consideration of whether the church has the authority to bring in a program devised by an unbeliever, cut and paste Bible verses to it, and market it as a Christ-centered recovery program. One justification is needed. It works. What is the consequence of something like that? Well, how would you like to kick your bad habit and go to hell? That's a big consequence, isn't it? What good does it do for someone to stop drinking or stop using drugs if they die and go to hell? Pragmatism kills people spiritually. I've sat around a table with other pastors and I've said, guys, I'm not trying to be a jerk here, but why do we have a woman teaching adultery in Sunday school every single Sunday at our church? When 1 Timothy 2:12 says, you must not do this. Why are we doing this? I'm not trying to be mean to you. And of course the answer is because people like her. And her class is well attended. And if we address the situation, that's going to rub some feathers in money and water. And that simply would not be practical. So we're going to continue on with the status quo. All down through history, God has honored men and women whose actions were motivated by love for Christ instead of expediency, pragmatism, or doing what works. Think about Martin Luther, who stood before the mighty Catholic Church at the Diet of Worms. Diet of Worms is just a council where you try a heresy. Okay? 1521, he faced the Catholic Church. Catholic Church said, Martin Luther, are these your books? Yes. Will you recant? Luther said, my conscience is captive to the Word of God. To go against conscience is neither right nor safe. I cannot and I will not recant anything. Here I stand, I can do no other. God help me. And you can just see Martin Luther's friends up in the balcony going, that's not practical. That doesn't work. Don't do that. Just recant, Martin. It would have been expedient to recant. But Luther loved Christ too much to do what was convenient at the cost of doing what was right. It could have cost him his life. He would have been burned at the stake had he not been rescued and carried out of town by some of his friends. Martin Luther knew the truth of Matthew 16:26. What will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? What can a man give in exchange for his soul? Like Caiaphas, we American Christians are very skilled at the art of conflict avoidance. It's not expedient to witness to your co-workers. They might not like you anymore. You might lose your job, or you might lose a big client. It's not expedient for the preacher to talk about sin or hell or the blood of Jesus because this makes people uncomfortable. It's not expedient to say what the Bible says about homosexuality or LGBTQ, ABCDEF behavior. Because then how can all the hard left people continue to come to church with you if you actually say what the Bible says? It's not expedient. And besides, some of you give a lot of money. It's not practical to sing hymns and preach a 50-minute expository sermon. I mean, why don't we just fire up the smoke and the lights and put the young, attractive people on stage and manipulate people's emotions and see if we can fill up the place and get the budget going here? And there's no point offending people, is there? We can keep everybody happy, can't we? You see, compromise is the name of the game in America. It's the name of the game in the American church. Let me ask you this question. What are you motivated by? What's the fundamental motivating force and factor in your life today? Is it convenience? Is it comfort? Is it preserving the status quo? Is it taking the path of least resistance? Do you just want to get through life without ruffling anybody's feathers? Any actions that flow from these kind of motivations are detestable to God. This is what Caiaphas and the Sanhedrin were doing. We don't care that Jesus just raised a man from the dead. Obviously, he's got to be the Son of God. We do not care. We have to do what is practical here. We have to save our place. We have to save our nation. We've got to kill Jesus. Look at verse 51 through 53. Speaking of Caiaphas, it says he did not say this of his own accord. But being high priest that year, he prophesied that Jesus would die for the nation. And not for the nation only, but also to gather into one the children of God who are scattered abroad. So from that day on, they made plans to put him to death. So Caiaphas spoke a prophecy. He said, guys, Jesus has to die for the nation. And of course, Caiaphas meant it in a political sense. Jesus needs to die so that he might save our nation as a political entity. But the Bible says that when Caiaphas was speaking, God was speaking, and he was saying something else. That Jesus is going to have to die for the spiritual welfare of his holy nation, the church. To save us from spiritual, not political, destruction. From eternity past, God had ordained that Christ would come and give his life as a ransom for sinners. Now Caiaphas, he had no idea that his prophecy was just a link in the chain that would move God's eternally decreed will along. Like Caiaphas, you and I either build on the truth or we will be crushed by it. We either build on the truth or we will be crushed by it. So Caiaphas wanted to save the temple. He wanted to save the nation. So he had Jesus killed. Well, 35 years after Jesus died, Roman general named Titus came down because the Jews had some kind of rebellion. And he destroyed the temple, and he destroyed the nation anyway, just 35 years after Christ died. Which reminds us that choosing what is expedient, pragmatic, convenient, never works in the long run. Being faithful to Christ is what works in the long run. We have to take a long view on things. So, how does God evaluate our actions? First thing we saw was that God hates actions motivated by expediency, which is a desire to get results. Second thing, final thing we see, is that God loves actions that are motivated by extravagant love for Christ. Look at chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. 6 days before the Passover, Jesus therefore came to Bethany, where Lazarus was, whom Jesus had raised from the dead. So they gave a dinner for him there. Martha served, and Lazarus was one of those reclining with him at the table. Well, Jesus knew that his hour had come. He's in the last week of his earthly life here. So from John 12 all the way up to like 20 is the last week of Jesus' life. Jesus knew about the council's decision to put him to death. He knew that Passover was drawing near. He knew that he had come into this world to be the true Passover lamb, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. So, Jesus raised Lazarus, then he withdrew to a town called Capernaum, which is about 12 or 13 miles from Jerusalem, and now Passover is coming, and Jesus comes back to Bethany, 2 miles from Jerusalem, and he's eating dinner with Lazarus, whom he has raised from the dead, and Mary, and Martha, and others. Can you imagine the warmth, the friendship, and the joy that must have pervaded this dinner atmosphere while Jesus is eating with his friends that he loves so much? He brought their brother back to them. Lazarus is alive again. Can you imagine how much these people love Jesus? Can you imagine how much Jesus needed this? He knows that in just a few short days, he's going to experience the most horrifying death that any man has ever experienced. I would imagine that Jesus really needed his friends to love on him at this point in time. And so they gave him a dinner. They showered him with their affection. Look at verse 3. Mary therefore took a pound of expensive ointment made from pure nard and anointed the feet of Jesus and wiped his feet with her hair. The house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. So, Mary of Bethany is everything that Caiaphas and the Sanhedrin are not. So, John means us to see like a character study. Look at Mary of Bethany. Look at Caiaphas. This is what you don't want to be. This is what you want to be. They're polar opposites. The other gospel writers call attention to the fact that Mary anointed the head of Jesus with his perfume. So, this is also recorded for us in the other gospels, this act of Mary anointing Jesus. But John focuses on the fact that Mary anoints Jesus' feet. His feet. And this is meant to highlight her deep, self-humbling love for Jesus. You see, in Jesus' day, you don't touch people's feet. They're nasty. The only person that washes people's feet is the lowest slave. But here's Mary of Bethany washing Jesus' feet. Mary takes this expensive ointment and pours the whole body of a bottle over Jesus' body from head to toe. There was a pound there. It went a long way. And then she wipes his feet with her hair. With her hair. Jewish women don't let their hair down in public because in that culture, if you let your hair down, it's a sign of loose morals. Look, she let her hair down. She's a pleaser. Well, Mary didn't care what people thought. Practical concerns were the farthest thing from Mary's mind. Her heart overflowed with love for Jesus, and she gave full expression to her love for him. While Caiaphas is concerned about doing what is expedient with Jesus, Mary is concerned about doing what is extravagant for Jesus. Look with me in verses 4 through 6, please. But Judas Iscariot, one of his disciples, he who was about to betray him, said, "Why was this ointment not sold for 300 denarii and given to the poor?" He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief, and having charge of the money bag, he used to help himself to what was put in it. So Judas was yet another pragmatist, a utilitarian fellow. He thought that worship was a waste. In Mary's heart and mind, no gift for Christ was too great. The perfume she poured on Jesus was worth 300 denarii. So, one denarius in Jesus' world is a day's wage. 300 denarii are 300 days' wages. That bottle of perfume was worth a year's wages for labor. In our modern money, it would be worth $35,000 to $40,000 if Jesus pours it all out. Mary's heart echoed the words of that great old hymn by Isaac Watts. "When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, my richest gain I count but loss and pour content on all my crime. Were the whole realm of nature mine, that were a present far too small. Love so amazing, so divine, demands my life, my soul, my all." Were the whole realm of nature mine, that were present far too small. What's $35,000 or $40,000 in the perfume? If I had the whole world, the highest mountain peaks, the most beautiful rivers, the deepest valleys, the lushest forests, if I had all of creation and I could give it to Christ, that would be a present far too small. Love so amazing, so divine, demands my life, my soul, my soul. So Judas was heralded, so to speak. He said that Mary should have done the pragmatic, the practical, the utilitarian thing, and sold the perfume to distribute the proceeds to the poor. Think about how many poor people you could have bought lunch for with the proceeds of that perfume, Mary. But Mary does the extravagant thing, pouring in all out as a love gift to the one that she adored. While Judas and the Sanhedrin are protecting their own interests, Mary considers the loss of a $40,000 bottle of perfume gain for Christ's sake. Another question. What is the driving force behind the decisions that you're making in life, the actions that you're taking? Is it expediency or is it extravagant love for Jesus? Is there something in your heart that has set your life on a trajectory where you are compelled to give more and more of your time and your talents and your resources and your energy and your very self to making much of Jesus? Is there something in you that set you on that kind of trajectory? That you might see other people come to know Christ? Is there a real desire in your heart to love Jesus through costly acts of worship? You know, Mary made a list of the pros and cons of anointing Jesus. And on the con side, she had net worth will go down by $40,000. I'm going to be humiliated by touching somebody's stinky feet. I'm going to let my hair down and make me look like a floozy. These guys are going to say that was the stupidest thing I've ever seen. That was on the con side. And on the pro side was, Jesus is worthy. And the pros won out. Because Christ was worth it. He was worthy. He was precious to Mary Bethany. Utility and expediency are not the criteria that God uses to measure success. A man named William Borden was born in 1887. Maybe you've heard of William Borden. If you haven't heard of William Borden, I'm sure you make some Borden cheese. William Borden's family was in the dairy business, and they were fantastically wealthy. He was born in 1887. He grew up in one of the wealthiest families in Chicago, fantastically rich. At the age of 12, William trusted in Christ, and he was the heir to the Borden Dairy Estate. At the age of 16, his parents financed a trip for him to go around the world to travel to see the globe. So William went out to travel all around the world on his daddy's big pocket in the water. And while he was out and about, he saw many missionaries, and he saw many people who had never heard of Christ, and he felt the call to be a foreign missionary. And so he let his dad know this, but while he was in Rome, his dad sent him a letter and said, "Son, don't make any major life decisions until you're 21. You're just 16 now. Wait until you're 21 before you make any big decisions like that." But William had seen the masses of miserable people who knew nothing of Christ, and he had made up his mind he was going to go to China as a missionary. And his father said, "I will not permit it until you are done with college." During his freshman year at college, William Borden's father died, and William Borden was given access to all his dad's money, the whole estate, everything. It was William Borden's. He instantly became one of the 8 or 10 wealthiest people in America. It was brought to William's attention while he was at college that nobody was doing anything to reach the Muslim world for Christ. And so he made plans to go to northern China. He graduated from college. He's going to be a full-time missionary to Chinese Muslims. But before he can do this, he has to go to Egypt and he has to learn Arabic. I mean, you can't take the gospel of Chinese Muslims who speak Arabic until you learn Arabic. So he had to go to Egypt. He had to learn Arabic. And while he was there in Egypt, he got spinal meningitis. And he died. Learning the Arabic language so that he could go to be a missionary to Chinese Muslims in northern China. William died at the age of 25 years old. He never reached his beloved China. He left when he died. He left $1 million for the China inland mission. $1 million to Moody Church, $1 million to Moody Bible Institute, $1 million to Princeton Seminary,
And this is in a day where there's no such thing as a billionaire. I mean, at the turn of the 20th century, $1 million would probably be like $1 billion now. Was it all in extravagant ways? I mean, here's William Morton. He's one of the richest 8 or 10 people in America. The guy died at 25 years old, never even gets to the mission field. What a waste, right? Wrong. Not a waste, because Jesus is worthy. William Morton's testimony and his legacy lives on today. We're talking about him right now because it was not a waste. Mary of Bethany's testimony and legacy lives on today. We're still talking about her and what she did for Jesus out of extravagant love 2,000 years later. The Gospel of Mark, chapter 14, verse 9, says this in the parallel account. Jesus says about Mary of Bethany, "Truly I say to you, wherever the gospel is proclaimed in the whole world, what she has done will be told in memory of her." Let me ask you this. What has it cost you to love Jesus Christ? Have you ever done anything impractical simply because you love Jesus? Have you ever done anything because you love Jesus that made the Judases of the world scratch their heads and say, I just can't figure out why that person would do that? Can you look back at your life and point to anything that you sacrificed simply because Jesus is worthy? Nothing that you have ever done or ever will do out of love and adoration for Christ is a waste. Look at verse 7. Jesus said, "Let it rain, so that she may keep it. For the day of my burial. For the poor you always have with you, but you do not always have me." So Mary knew that Jesus was about to die, even though Christ's own disciples didn't really get it at this point. They hadn't registered on the apostles. You know, we see Mary of Bethany three times in the Gospels. If you remember, I believe it's the Gospel of Luke. She and her sister Martha are cooking dinner for Jesus, and Martha's running around doing all the work. What's Mary of Bethany doing? She's sitting at Jesus' feet and listening to Jesus. And then when Jesus was coming back to raise Lazarus from the dead, if you remember, in John chapter 11, Mary ran out, and the text says she fell down at Jesus' feet and said, "Lord, if you'd been here, my brother would not have died." And now here in John 12, we see Mary again, wiping Jesus' feet with her hair. Every time you see Mary Bethany in the Gospels, she is at the feet of the Lord Jesus. How did she know it was time to take that perfume and anoint Jesus for his burial with everyone else in the city, when even his own apostles had not had this reality raised to her own? How did she know that? Because she spent a lot of time sitting at Jesus' feet. When we sit at the feet of Jesus, we come to insights that are life-transforming. Not only did Mary know that Jesus was about to die, but she also understood how precious, how valuable, how wonderful, how glorious his death would be. And how better to show the value of Christ's death than by anointing his body for burial with his beautiful, costly fragrance? You know, nothing is more valuable than Jesus. Nothing is more precious than the blood of Jesus. Nothing is more excellent than the sacrificial, substitutionary death of Jesus Christ. He is the God-man. He is infinitely worthy. He is worthy of infinite glory and praise and honor. There is no one and nothing more valuable than the Lord Jesus Christ. His blood has taken away our sins. He has made us righteous. He has given us eternal life. What could be greater than Christ, more precious than Christ? Do you know Christ today? Do you know this wonderful, worthy, precious, glorious Jesus today? Have you received the priceless benefits of his death? Have you received the forgiveness of sins through his blood? Have you received the free gift of righteousness by trusting in him? Have you received an eternity of face-to-face fellowship with the God-man, Jesus Christ? You know what Lazarus was doing around the table with Jesus there in John 11, sitting across the table, face to face, eating with Jesus after his generation of death? That's a picture of what we're going to get to experience in the age here. Jesus is unspeakably worthy, unspeakably beautiful, unspeakably wonderful. Do you know Jesus today? Do you love Jesus Christ today? Well, how does God evaluate our actions? He looks at the motives of our heart. Actions motivated by pragmatism, convenience, expediency, and desire to get some kind of result, doing what works. That's a stench in the nostrils of God. But it is a sweet aroma in the nostrils of God when we say and do things that are motivated by a heart overflowing with extravagant love for Jesus. May God open the eyes of our heart this year to see the surpassing worth of Jesus more and more. May God give us a heart overflowing with love for Jesus rather than love for what works. He is worthy. He is wonderful. May we sit at His feet this year and get a glimpse of His beauty. Let's pray. Our Father, we thank You for the worth and the excellence and the greatness and the goodness and the splendor of Jesus Christ. He is the most beautiful person in the cosmos. And I pray that You would help us to know Him today. Help us to love Him, Lord. Free us from lesser love. We pray that You would give us the kind of heart that You gave Mary of Bethany, a heart that didn't care what people thought, a heart that just wanted to show love to the one who has saved her by His grace. Lord, You save so many of us by Your grace. And we confess that our affections for You are often cold, and that we often do not treasure You in our hearts as we should. And oftentimes, Lord, that we are saying and doing things that are just convenient, prop up the status quo, things that are very driven by a desire to be practical and get some kind of result, instead of a desire to see Christ honored. So we ask that You would change our hearts. We ask that You would show us the greatness of Jesus, Holy Spirit. We ask that You would help these words to penetrate into our hearts and minds and leave it here. We know that You use His word to change us. That's the chief instrument of change. To see in ourselves where we're like Caiaphas or Jesus. And help us to see in ourselves and where You have been making us like Mary. And we pray for less of the former and more of the latter. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. I come to the Lord's table. I'm just going to have you play a couple of verses and we'll think about the things that we've heard. All their hope on the death and resurrection of Christ. So if you're with us this morning and you're not
never been baptized, or did you not partake? Why did you believe and then partake with us? The Lord's table is for saved sinners, so sin is not something that should keep you away from the table, unless there is some sin in your life that you are committed to and away with, but that you're not repenting. So if that's the case for you, we would ask that you would abstain as well, if you can make that right with the Lord. After you receive the elements, hold on to it, and we'll partake of it together. And at the white table on the brim of the room. Everybody racing to try to get this loose because they don't know what's going to happen about the little pop off. In the same way, also, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant, not blood. Do this as often as you drink it.
Thank you.
to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing.